C4 and Bryan Neman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Well, we're always pleased we can have the County Executive of Baltimore County, Johnny Olszewski, on board and in studio. First of all, good morning, County Executive.
Good morning,
sir. Good morning.
There you go. Great to have you back in as well. Let's begin, though, with an issue that has really been important to our audience, let our parents, and preface it by saying we understand you do not control the Baltimore County Public School System. You provide a lot of money to the Baltimore County School System. You're a former teacher. But the issue of school violence, which has been captured on many of the students' telephones, been going out. They had an emergency meeting, a virtual meeting with Dr. Darrell Williams and the school board last week, County Executive. What are you hearing that's going on in the schools, and what can you tell parents that are listening about how it's being addressed?
Well, the first thing I would tell parents is that I'm coming at this and all other issues as a parent myself. I have a first grader that goes to school in Baltimore County. I was a public school teacher in Baltimore County. I was a student in the school system. So this comes from a very personal place for me. And we know that safety, particularly in our schools, is one of the most top priorities and one of the most sacred obligations we have as leaders. And to the extent we can do more to help it, I am absolutely going to do whatever I can to ensure that our kids are safe. That's why we've not only supported and sustained our nationally recognized national model of school resource officers, we expanded it in last year's budget. We have put in money for additional teachers, even though our enrollment's gone down, so class sizes are smaller. And as a former teacher, I know that the smaller the class size, the better control you have over your class. We have more pupil personnel workers. We have more social workers. We have more counselors to help with the social emotional well-being of our students. We've supported the school system putting in safety assistance on top of the school resource officers. We're investing capital dollars in the school security and school safety functions, whether it's cameras or other issues. That's what we can and we're going to keep doing. We're going to also call for and demand accountability in terms of when students are particularly violent, there have to be consequences. And that is absolutely a function of the school system. So we continue to call on that to be the case anytime there is, because students need to know there's going to be consequences. And then the other piece is, look, the number one indicator of a child's success, the number one indicator of a child's safety is parental involvement. So if parents aren't involved, I would encourage them to be involved, to show up in their schools. We've opened the school buildings. They're allowed to be in there. They're allowed to observe and be present. So I would encourage parents to also be involved. But we take this issue very seriously. I'm going to keep doing whatever I can from my perspective to do that, and then hopefully keep seeing progress from the school system as well.
I think the most frustrating part for parents has been, well, why is there any kind of resistance to going tougher on children who commit, these violent acts in the schools? I couch this as knowing that you're not in charge of the schools, but what is your opinion on what is happening? Because we hear from parents, and look, I'm not in Baltimore County, but I see the same thing in my public school system. Seems there's more fights, more behavioral issues, and we hear from teachers about this as well. And I know you talk to students, they don't like the distractions class, so why not give some tough love? What's the resistance from the administrative point of view do you see that is happening where we're not being tougher on kids that have behavioral problems in schools?
Well, I don't want to speak for the administrators and the people who are, in the building every day. But what I can say is, it depends on how old a child is. It depends on, for me at least, how severe the offense is. I think we do believe in giving kids chances to recognize that they did something wrong and improve. I don't know that going straight to an expulsion for a more minor offense is the right answer. But also, if it's serious enough or if it's persistent enough, there have to be consequences at the end of that continuum. So
let's talk about Delaney. Let's talk about Lansdowne High. Let's talk about Perry Hall High. Let's keep me up to high school level. I understand it might be some different situations, middle and elementary school, but we've had high schools where these things are going on, 16, 17, 18-year-olds. And alternative, I'm not saying expulsion, go home, but alternative educational patterns for students who are continually disruptive. What we're hearing from parents is that is not an option. They're being told that's not an option, an alternative learning environment.
Well, for students who should know better or who are older, if we're talking high school, if it's persistent or particularly violent, these children deserve to have an education, but
yes,
it doesn't have to be in the school and the same classroom as the students with
whom
they were violent or the teachers
executive
with whom they were violent. Mm-hmm. I can tell you from personal experience, having had a chair thrown at me, that student was removed from that environment and learning continued. Had that student been returned when I was teaching,
it
would have disrupted not just my ability to teach, but the entire classroom. So we have to find ways to provide that education to all of our kids, but to do so in a way that's also fair and equitable to the teachers and the educators and the support staff and the students. And ultimately, those decisions are 100% governed by our school boards. So to the extent that's not happening, we certainly call on that to be the case.
Last time you were here, I think we were discussing about, you know, whether or not the school system was going to get additional dollars from the county, and you said you were not going to raise taxes to give more money. And they came up with money. They found money. They found surplus money. They found COVID relief money.
$60 million.
I can't remember the exact.
Like 70 million.
I think it was 70 million. I think it was like 30 here, 40 there, something like that. But I'm just curious, as you look at the math of that, is that sustainable or is that a one-time thing? Like, is that going to be able to continue for the next 5 years, 10 years down the road, or are you going, is this a one-time type of raise for teachers that they're going to get out of this?
Look, you know, like many other professions, teaching has been very difficult. That difficulty has been exacerbated these past 2 years. So I've always said that we want to pay our teachers and educational staff more. We've gone from middle of the pack in Baltimore County to some of the highest salaries in the state as a result of our work. That was before this additional $70 million that we came to. But I also said, and I was on the show before saying, it has to be fiscally responsible and sustainable. And I'm proud that the $70 plus million we announced actually is in fact sustainable. It is fiscally responsible. A lot of it is coming as one-time COVID relief funding, which will be in the form of bonuses, very significant amount that this year for that. there will be a significant amount to make our what was scheduled to be a mid-year 3% COLA. It's now going to be a full-year COLA. That's coming out of their fund balance. So it's a one-time use of one-time bonus dollars. And then we added a second, not a first, but a second step mid-year where they're going to have basically another that is the one ongoing pay increase that our teachers are going to see. The good news there is that the vast majority of that $20 million, the school system came to us and said, we have identified operational savings and cuts that we can make to roll that into our budget next year. So into the budget process next year, we're going to take that $18 million of savings and put that in as a placeholder.
So they're not going to be able to hold it over your head to say, look, unless we get more money, we're going to have to take back this raise from the teachers.
Correct. And, you know, it was pretty unprecedented to do budgeting after the budget was done. So we were open to it. But we said, if we're going to do it this one time, we're going to make sure it is fiscally responsible and sustainable. And as we go forward, the money is there to sustain that increase in addition to the one-time dollars coming through this year. And then next year, through the normal budget process, we will sit down with the system, with you know, the education leaders, with the public, and say, what are the priorities? What can we afford? And if we can do more, we'll do more on top of what we've done this year. But just for perspective, this year's increase was $70 million more before this additional funding.
Mm-hmm.
$70 million above maintenance of effort if you use enrollment-based MOE. One of the largest in the state. Last year, I gave the largest MOE in the state of Maryland to our school system. So it is not for lack of funding from Baltimore County. We have put forward more increases than any other prior administration, but that has to be coupled with accountability and sustainability. We can't always put this at the foot of our residents to pick up the requirements and pick up the costs. So we're really proud of what we've done for our school system. We're proud of this. You know, our teachers deserve this additional funding this year, bus drivers, our cafeteria workers, our substitutes. But we have to be able to sustain it because otherwise we're going to end up worse off by not doing it responsibly.
Baltimore County Executive Johnny Olszewski is in studio with us. And County Executive, you know, we also hear from a lot of parents that it was great that the county could, school system could realign its budget and come up with this pandemic relief money. A lot of parents want to know how much money did they actually have? Like one of the questions as always has been, do they have to report that to you, the county council? Like how much money are they sitting on of pandemic relief?
We know that they've gotten more in pandemic relief than the county itself got. Hundreds of millions of dollars. We have some general sense of the places where they...
Do they have to report that, though?
Not with any real granularity. And that's one of the things that... So I'm soon to be first vice president of the Maryland Association of Counties. It's one of our legislative priorities this year. It's going to be really having that transparency as the primary funding source of our school system, to have that level of granularity, accountability, transparency from our school systems so that we can see where that money is
parents
going,
know
where
too.
It's coming from, what it's going towards. It's one of the requirements that they have to give to the oversight board for the blueprint. But we're just saying, give us that same level of oversight in terms of information and where that funding is going. You know, you guys know one of the hallmarks of our administration is we've really tried to be open, transparent, accessible. We've got online dashboards. You can see our county budget down to the check. We're just asking for the same.
You have an inspector general.
We have an inspector general.
That's right.
Who we created.
I know.
And we've expanded.
You gave more to our office, yeah.
And look, that's what accountable government should look like. You shouldn't be afraid of, opening yourself up to scrutiny. Not everyone's going to agree with everything you do, but I would rather people trust that the decisions being made are going to be done in an open way where people can look at it, make their own judgments, and be part of the process.
Security Square Mall, C4 worked there back in the
80s. Sportswear, men's company.
I learned something new. Yeah,
that's right.
So he's very, very sad about what it looks like these days.
It's really bad.
You're putting $10 million into this project. What exactly is going to happen, and why is it worthy of county money? Like, why not just, allow somebody else to take this thing over? Why does the county have to get involved in this?
Oh, I would say we're getting involved because we've seen the decline over the past 10-plus years, and we have had tremendous public outcry asking for us to do more. We've already seen some immediate progress. We saw the old IHOP and the old Bennigan's have come down. They've been eyesores for years. We have a new Chick-fil-A coming up there. We actually have $20 million on this site. So working with Speaker Adrian Jones, we put up $10 million locally.
The state's got 10.
The state put 10 in as well. We used about half of it to buy the old Sears building. But this is a really prime parcel, probably one of the most prime parcels overall for potential redevelopment and reimagining what's possible there. We decided we wanted to have some actual direct skin in the game to help drive that work. So we bought the building. We're one of the owners now, at least for now. The county doesn't do redevelopment, but we've brought in national experts to do the charrette process that's underway, where we are engaging the other owners on that site. We're engaging the community. We're bringing in development experts, economists, transportation experts to say what really is possible here, to see if we can develop a shared vision. That site can and should be so much more than what it is. It has so much history and people remember it. And we wanted to just sort of be that site again for
but is the ultimate goal to get out of it and then sell and make money off of it, or is it always going to be partly owned by the county in some way?
The ultimate goal is to have it be what the community desires it to be. We've heard a lot of calls for restaurants and open space and different kinds of shopping. People want to see maybe some training centers. That's the whole point of the charrette process, is we're not walking in with this is what it's going to be. This is what the county's position is going to be. We're pretty much open, whether it's...
The free market decide that? I guess that's what my point is. I mean, if it's such a prime piece of real estate and everybody wants all these things, then wouldn't some developer come in and say, let me write you a check for this. We're going to make a ton of money off of this. I mean, my concern is that you're putting money into this thing and it doesn't ever take off and nothing ever happens from it, and then taxpayers are out $10 million or maybe even $20 million.
Well, I think what we know is that what's been happening hasn't been working. There's been a lack of clarity and purpose and consensus around that site. No one has been able to actually bring the rest of the owners together in a meaningful way. And I will say $20 million will get developers' attention, will get owners' attention to say, oh, there is
something's happening here.
Something's happening here. So sometimes it does require incentives. I do think the right mix of community input, resources, and conversations can really transform this site. Again, it hasn't happened over the last 10 or 20 years. In fact, it's only declined more, and the community has overwhelmingly said this is one of the most important projects that we want to see redeveloped. And sometimes that does include and require some supports. We do that all the time with incentives and enterprise zones, and this is just a different way of
going
at
it. We do it in the city with TIFs and pilots and everything.
That's right.
Anyway, Baltimore County Executive Jenny Olszewski, finally from me, and that is the fact that a year ago, October the 12th, 2021, you announced something called the Towson Loop. And 1 year later, 45,000 folks
We're
riding
over
around?
Over 45,000 now. Yeah, it was 45,000 on the anniversary. I think it was a really big day for Baltimore County, the first fixed route transit service that we've ever stood up by ourselves. It's a free ride. We have the orange and the purple lines. Speaking of purple, I just want to thank the Ravens for an awesome new destination playground in Owings Mills that they helped us put up yesterday. Folks should check it out. But the loop's great. It runs every 15, 20 minutes, Monday through Friday, and on Saturday. We're excited to have tens of thousands of residents hop on and take a ride. We're hopeful that it becomes a model for other communities that would similarly benefit from it. But really proud of it. A year in and in the middle of a pandemic.
In the pandemic, exactly.
To have that many riders. So we're hopeful that that number only grows in the year ahead. But we're very excited about it.
One last question for me, and I know this is another question that you're not in charge of this. But this whole fight about when to count the mail-in ballots in the election coming up, and the court said, yes, you can count them right away, right when they come in. But most counties are saying, we can't do it. We don't have the space to do it. What is your thought on that? And there was is it in Baltimore County? I'm getting my counties mixed up. I think it was Baltimore County. They said you didn't have the space to
right,
do it.
That's what they said initially.
That seems to be like the most ridiculous thing. How is there not enough space to count votes in Baltimore County? You've got to have a building somewhere where people can go.
And as soon as I was made aware of that, we found space. And miraculously enough, we are now counting ballots before Election Day.
So there will be ballots counted in Baltimore County.
Yeah, so probably. I mean, let me just first say, I think that counting ballots as quickly and efficiently and correctly as possible is the most important thing we can do to give certainty to this election. I fully support having as many ballots counted as possible before Election Day, and then obviously not sharing that information until the polls are closed. But yeah, we were made aware that there were some limitations and the County Board of Elections hadn't intended to. I think it was a combination of space and just the timing of the board decision. As soon as we were made aware, I said, this is not going to be the reason. That's not going to be a holdup for us. We immediately found space to do additional trainings and or counting. We now have at least 3 full days of counting scheduled. And we're confident that maybe not all, but many, many, many of the ballots that are submitted here in Baltimore County will be counted and posted on Election Day, which I think is better for the certainty of the election.
Absolutely.
Better for the process. Having tens of thousands of ballots after the fact, I don't think is helpful for anybody.
Election Day is much better than election month. So that's one of the issues. Thank you, County Executive Johnny. Always great to have you in studio.
Always a pleasure, guys. Thank you.